Can we all agree that economists are as overpaid as weathermen?
Of course, detached houses are still going crazy. Townhouses are still going crazy.
Are foreign owners of empty homes to blame for Canada's unaffordable housing?
Oh no, there was something about last week.
Thank you for bringing that up. After this, because that we might have to sit down for that. I dominated both of these diamonds
in T-ball, and then you probably went to high school. Well, no, you were probably more of a college person. You went to college and put in a different form of subpar performance.
Hospitality management, I'm sure.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Sharp Stories.
Sharp Stories, the first market update in Sharp Stories. This is the November 2021 market update, mm-hmm. 1 week into December 2021. We're almost done here.
We are almost done. It's crazy thinking that it's almost the end of the year, but doesn't it feel like COVID has been going on for forever, yet it feels like, I don't know, 2 weeks ago it was 2020, January. It's flown by.
That makes sense, actually.
So,
it's exactly how it feels.
Not everything I say is complete ludicrous, so hard for you to believe.
1% value.
Much of a muchness. Same typical story. So buyer demand is still very much on the rise, and obviously inventory is at massively lower levels. We're expecting to see that, to be honest, as we round out the year anyway. I think the board's economist said that we're probably going to be at record levels when we end the year, possibly just below it.
Can we all agree that economists are as overpaid as weathermen?
It's
need to put that in. You don't have to agree. Continue.
Okay. It's one of those interesting jobs, isn't it? Because they just come up with economic policy, but they're not held to that and responsible for getting it right and for implementing it. So it's kind of like, you can
paid
do your
guess.
Job and it doesn't, yeah, exactly, paid to guess.
Not that I have anything against them.
But it's a fascinating subject, but that's for another day. So, we're seeing much of a muchness here. So, sales...
That's not a North American term.
It doesn't matter. You were founded
much
by my...
Much of a muchness.
Much of a muchness. I'm bringing it here. I'm international. I'm taking Sharp Stories international. Anyway, so sales, November 2021 versus November 2020. We are up by this.
Yes.
Typically, as you would expect, we are down inventory by this. Now, we've kind of been saying the same thing.
We've just rounded home, for the record.
We've just rounded home.
That's what they say. We've rounded home. We're going around again.
Never going to use that.
Sorry, keep going.
Again. So, what we've really noticed is, of course, detached houses are still going crazy. Townhouses are still going crazy. But it's still working in pockets. So I think apartments, for example, or no, the overall home price index rose just 1% from October 2020.
1%, yeah.
Yep. So when you look at our sales to active listings ratios, townhouses, they're at like 74%. Detached houses are at, I think, 33.9%. And regular apartments are at, I want to say about 53%. But depending on what area you're shopping in, that's very different. So it's still the same story. It's just now broken up into different areas of the market. Now, where I think the most opportunity is for a potential buyer looking to get in the market right now.
Some more detailed insight.
Yeah, so there's two areas. The biggest opportunity, I reckon, is in that kind of apartment, $1 million to 1.5, maybe possibly 1.4.
Why do you say that?
Because obviously the detached market is crazy busy, mm-hmm. as it has been for a while. Home prices have risen massively. And the way it is right now, if you're in that realm and you are looking at buying a property, the likelihood is everyone would have gone for the detached house.
Yep.
Which has kind of left condos, and it makes sense because there's this awkward part in the middle because entry-level homes are still very busy. So you're seeing a lot on the market of that kind of $1 million to 1.4, possibly 1.5 range that are just sitting and accumulating days on market.
Condos.
Yes.
So you think in that overlap area or that close pocket, people are getting priced out or negotiated out of housing, so they're just saying, let's just do a condo?
Well, I'm saying that the people who were originally shopping in that area have typically gone for houses, and that's pushed the prices of houses up. So of course, nine times out of 10, if you've got that money and you can afford to buy a house, you're really gonna buy a house rather than the apartment. So now that the home prices have become pushed up, it's left all of this inventory on the market in that range, because that's something I really want to stress. Inventory is crazy low right now, but in some areas there's a fair amount of inventory, and some price points there's a decent amount of inventory, and that range, you can see places that have been on the market for 3+ months that there's still an opportunity. So I think if you're looking to be a savvy buyer and take advantage of the market, that's where you do it now. But again, taking advantage of the market does not mean that you're gonna get something that's cheaper, 30% below market value or something like that. But that's where I think you're gonna be doing it. And that's where I think you can even get in and avoid the whole multiple offer scenario. You can have a little bit more patience, you can view your types of properties, you can add your subjects in there, and you can probably get a discount on a lot of those properties as well.
Yeah, and with that little pocket as well, for those all those points, days on market, as you said, are mounting. Mm-hmm. So you've got sellers mm-hmm. saying, why is this market? I thought this market was busy. Mm-hmm. In general, what's going on? And when you hammer down, as you just said as well, the micro pockets are what you need to look at. So when you've got days on market mounting, that helps these buyers.
And the other trick is with days on market is make sure when you're talking to your realtor, you're asking them to look at days on market for the entirety, because a lot of the times a realtor will take the property off and relist it as if it's new. It will show that it's been on the market for say 10, 15, 20 days, but it could have just been pulled off of the market and re-put back on.
Great trick.
A lot of the times you see that and you go back into the history and it's been on for like the last 4 to 6 months. That's very different from a property which says 7 days. The other area of the market is kind of in on that west side area.
Where we are right now.
Where we are right now in Dunbar. And the T-Bar.
T-Ball. T-ball. Jesus. Dunbar Little League.
Diamond, which is... Is it a diamond?
T-Bar. It's
T-Ball. Anyway.
In theory, yeah. The bases are set on a diamond.
Okay.
Come on. They didn't teach you this for the passport test?
No. Wow. They did not. But it's on those building lots on the west side that are kind of in that... around that 3 million range.
Okay.
And because I just think if you've got, again, this, and this is only going to apply to a certain amount of buyers because not everyone has the funds to do so.
In every statement, that's the
but
caveat.
You've got, obviously, if you're looking to buy on the east side, a development lot, you know you're going to be in multiple offers. You know that soon as it comes on market, you need to be there as soon as possible, and you really need to be going subject free. But there are still a lot of those lots that are on the west side that, again, have had some properties that have just been sat there, people hoping to get a figure for it that they can't, and then they've built up times on market. You do the days on market trick to check how long it's been on, and I think there's some opportunity for sales there and for discount on that as well. That's just my two cents, and I'm going to shut up for once.
That has been a lot of talking.
And I'm going to let you talk, sir, because we are all dying to hear what you're going to say.
You going to time me? Is that what that means?
Dear God, no.
Now we're going to go into another segment. I'm going to rename the segment within the segment.
Okay, so we're going into another segment. We need a new location. Can't stand on this fake T-Bone diamond anymore.
No, we're going anywhere.
We're going to another segment. And we will get back to the market update, guys, but Jay wants to discuss some random important topics.
The new segment, which is called Vancouver Real Estate News.
Okay. No, that's not a thing.
It is. We Google it, we talk about what comes up.
And by we, you mean you.
Yeah. So anyway, I've got the latest news again. This is turning into my favorite part of this. And I'm going to say the titles. We're not going to read into it. We're going to title read.
Okay.
Like all the young kids do these days.
Okay.
And then we're going to get your 2 cents on it.
Okay.
And I might have to sprinkle a couple cents on there myself.
More than a couple cents, I'm sure.
Is Canada's central bank afraid of reining in the housing market? Housing monster, sorry.
Oh, 1,000%.
Are they?
Yeah, 1,000%. They keep... How long have they mentioned about rates being increased and then it actually not happening? And then, they're still talking about it, and inflation's getting to a point now that they're getting stuck between a rock and a hard place.
We're going to raise. We're going to raise.
And then they don't. And then the conversation is now more geared towards, okay, it's going to be a slow, incremental raise. It's not going to make that much of a difference. But again, no action. And it's been pretty crazy for a long time now. So, yes.
Okay.
You disagree?
Of course I don't disagree. How do you think they... How easy was it to get a mortgage in the last 2 years? Just throwing money at everyone. Okay, that's more than 2 cents. Property tax hike imminent.
Well, taxes are always on the rise, so that wouldn't surprise me. Didn't they just raise taxes as well, especially in Vancouver?
Careful.
Saved your life.
Oh, well, thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah, obviously.
So, yeah.
Gouge the homeowners again. To my point about 2 weeks ago when we were here, screwing the owners.
Yeah.
Always. Every policy, nothing helps the owners. Anyway, we won't get into that again.
Again, more money. They're at quite a bit of a deficit.
Why is that?
Right now. Well, okay, so...
Because they're goddamn bankrupt.
Yeah. Okay, but surprise thing here. So a lot of the... And this is just going to quick side off because we could have a whole conversation about this. But a lot of the, for lack of a better phrase, stimulus that came out to help during COVID and the free money being given away and what that would do to the debt deficit, et cetera, et cetera. A lot of that is because the government just cannot afford people defaulting. So I think when you when they're forced to do a situation like that and just giving money to people and phrasing it as, this is the best thing we can do, we're looking after you. It's like, no, as a government, we cannot have this happen. Otherwise, we're ruined.
Well,
they're of course going to look to try and generate their money back in ways, shapes and forms. So yes, property tax is going up. It's obviously more on a local level, but I would imagine that's one of a variety of changes coming to most Canadian households.
Yep. Okay.
Continue.
Are foreign owners of empty homes to blame for Canada's unaffordable housing? This is one of my personal favorites.
No, I don't think so.
Obviously not. Every Canadian throwing money at the wall. Apparently you're going to have to fact check me on this.
Okay.
We are the most indebted of the G7 nations, our citizens.
Yeah.
Our beautiful Canadians. Mm-hmm. And then let's just shift the buck. God forbid we're at fault for anything. Let's blame the damn foreign owners of empty homes. The biggest bullshit tagline of all time.
Speaking about fact checking.
There was something about last week.
Thank you for bringing that up. After this,
because that we might have to sit down for that. Prominent, you won't know about this. I grew up around this. The prominent haunted house at
Canby, it's for sale, right?
In 25th, put on the market for $26 million. So that's been haunted.
Mm-hmm.
There was a news article in like 95.
I was 5 years old.
What?
I was 5 years old.
Yeah. So that's when it kicked off as being haunted. Canadian real estate prices expected to rise 9.2% in 2022. You think it'll happen?
Such a Canadian again. Like, don't talk to me about comparing Nova Scotia with Dunbar or comparing West Vancouver.
General 9.2 amortized out across the whole country.
Yeah, I can see it happening.
Okay.
I can see it being more.
Oh, wow. Okay. Canada's real estate market in 2022. What to expect in the new year? That's not a statement. Bank of Canada only sees two real estate bubbles, and Vancouver isn't one of them. We're not going to go into what they do believe is, but they do not believe this home and native land is one of them.
Depending on what view about it, I can see a lot of the other kind of typically less desirable areas to live, like Vancouver, Toronto, etc., will be more big cities, more desirable to live. I can imagine the smaller areas, like Timmins in Ontario, for example, that like went through the roof prices. I can see those settling down and calming down, but I would still say that we're in a bubble.
Oh, so you disagree with that?
It's just not, it may not be as big as a burst as some of these other areas, so it depends on what they're defining as their criteria, but we're not going to read into it.
Okay. Housing prices will rise higher in 2022. Okay, another one. Review of blind bidding in BC real estate market to look at rules elsewhere. So they're looking elsewhere at rules to see what we can bring in while reviewing the blind bidding options here in BC.
Once again, you want to just avoid doing the right thing and having a look at zoning and permitting and what else can help the process.
Blame the process.
You're going to put a band-aid over a knife wound, but you continue to do so.
And last but not least, co-ownership gains traction as housing prices keep rising.
Co-ownership?
In these articles, these four women, I presume, are co-purchasing a home. Two families buying together.
I think it's just from the mortgages perspective, right? Like, I don't think we've come across plenty where families have bought together, etc. But it's just
but like your family and my family, not two generations of my family.
No, I get that, and that's what I'm saying. So, but essentially, it's the same sort of thing. The same amount of owners makes no difference to us and the market. It's just if they can get pre-approved.
So it's they're saying it that they can't get pre-approved because it's so out of reach that families need to band together to purchase real estate.
Well, we had one earlier in the year, and it got declined, and
because the mortgage details.
Well, it's more technical. People you're trying to put on there, the more financial responsibility there is. So I can see that. But if it works, it works.
Okay. Those are the points today for Vancouver real estate news. Now we go into the fun part. We go into.
Now we've got to do the rest of the market update first. Then we'll get to the fun part.
Okay.
So we mentioned sales. Inventory is taking quite a hit as well, as we know. But just to give you the perspective of things, inventory has gone down November 2020 versus November 2021 this much. Although I guess I should point down because it's gone down.
Now, do you think that's general or because it's December or both?
I think it's both. So as we've said many a times before, the trajectory of what happens with our market, if you look at it from like a trend perspective, it typically follows the same trend, no matter if it's a busy or a soft market. It just happens on different levels.
I like to call that a trend band.
Okay. So the trend is still following the same trend, but it's just happening on different levels. So as we go into the winter, of course, things start to slow down a little bit, but it will just slow down on a different level as if it was like a dead market, for lack of a better phrase. So as we start getting into Christmas, you would start to expect some home buyer demand to slow down, but again, not enough because the difference in inventory is huge. So don't expect demand to come flashing down all of a sudden. And as we mentioned, rates have kind of not started to increase yet. I think that's going to be the turning point for when we're going to start seeing the inventory and the buyer demand kind of even itself out, or when they really start talking about it actually happening rather than the kind of thing. But until then, I think it's going to be much of a muchness. Your favorite saying. You like how I threw that in there?
No one still understands what you're talking about.
I think that's it.
That's not it. We need one more main section. I feel like getting apologized to on the swings.
Fine. Okay.
Okay?
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, it's come to my attention. Do I have to do this?
Yes. Quickly.
It's come to my attention that after being fact-checked, I was wrong last week about the amount of rainfall that takes place in Vancouver versus the Amazon rainforest. I ridiculed Jay for it, and I should not have done. It wasn't big, it wasn't clever, and I wasn't impressing anyone. And I was raised, I was brought up, not dragged up. And that is not typical of the behavior I should have shown. And so for that reason, Jay, I would like to make a formal apology. And I'm saved by the bell. Annie.
I haven't even accepted the apology
yet. I'm
good,
sir. How are you?
Oh, my God. It doesn't count.
Wonderful. Talk to me. So
what the hell was that?
No, not at all. Not busy at all. Carry on.
No.